Good morning, Facebook. Good morning. How is everybody doing today? Excuse this hair. Let me know if the background music is too loud. If you haven't already, join my group, add my group, House of Prayer and Sisters in Christ, if you want to be a part of those. So today's message is, are you going to be a victim or a victor? That is today's word for today. I am locking my hair, so y'all know how the process go when you going through the ugly stage. So ain't nobody gonna see my locks until they get a little longer, and probably so I color them. So so I got some locks up under here. I'm starting my lock journey. But anywho, so I hope y'all are doing well this morning. So the Holy Spirit gave me a word while I was in the shower, and I just wanted to come on here real quick and share it with you guys. So it's, are you going to be a victim or a victor? Let me know if the background music is too loud. I just needed some kind of vibe. So I took notes. So the question I want to ask you, and I'm not just talking to y'all, I'm talking to myself too, because I be needing a lot of encouragement, especially on this walk with the Lord. Sometimes I be needing people to encourage me. Like, I don't just be bored getting on here. I be really trying to bring the words to people and encourage some people. So are you going to be a victim of your circumstances? That is the question. So I'm talking to myself too as I'm talking to you guys. Are you going to be a victim of your circumstances? So I wrote, as I was sitting in the car before I got on here, the Lord was speaking to me and he was giving me the words to write. Because sometimes when I'm giving a message, I'll lose my train of thought. So I took notes so I wouldn't leave nothing out. But he was speaking to me and he was just telling me, as I wrote, in life, we don't always have control over our circumstances, but we do have control over how we handle our circumstances or how we react to certain situations. So we don't always have control over the things that happen to us. But we have control, we have power over how we react to them. I hope that makes sense. So every day that you wake up, you have control over how your day goes. You have control over that. You may not have control over if you in a car accident, or you may not have control over if you get fired from your job, or if you or if somebody passed away that you know. Some things we just absolutely have no control over. That's just life. That's just life. But we have control over how we handle those things. We have control over that. So you may not have control over your circumstances, but you have control over how you react to those circumstances or how you handle those circumstances. So you have the choice to be happy every day. You had a choice to be sad every day. You had a choice to be stressed. You have the choice to be depressed. You have a choice. I'm talking to myself too. I have a choice, because sometimes I don't be want to get on here and do what God tell me to do, or say what he tell me to say. Sometimes I don't be feeling like it. But you have to remember that obedience is better than sacrifice. So I have to be obedient to God and do what he tell me to do, or say what he tell me to say, to encourage and to uplift other people, because that's what it's all about. We supposed to edify the body of Christ, Not tear each other down, not pull each other down, not hate on each other, not talk about each other, not judge each other. But we're supposed to edify the body of Christ. So you don't have to be an evangelist or a pastor or a minister to edify the body of Christ. But if that's what I'm going to do, you know, if that's my calling, then I have to be an example even when I don't want to be. So Philippians chapter 4 and verse 7 says, "The peace of God which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." So this is what I do. When I'm in a situation or if I'm just feeling down or no energy or feeling like I ain't got no confidence or feeling confused or I don't know what to do or I may be slightly worried about I don't have enough money to pay this bill or whatever, I pray and I say, "Lord, give me a peace that surpasses all understanding." That's what you have to do. We have to acknowledge God in all of our ways. Okay, the Bible tells us to trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. I'm going to say that again because somebody probably need to hear that because I have to remind myself of this. He says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, okay? Lean not unto your own understanding, but in all of your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. So what does that mean? First, you have to trust in him with all your heart. Okay, that's the first step. And then number two, you have to acknowledge him in every aspect in your life, in every area in your life, no matter what it is. Whether it be work or school, relationships, family, whatever it is. Whatever it is. He said, trust in him with all your heart and lean not unto your own understanding. So that means that he knows what's best for us. He knows what we need more than what we think we know we need. So if we trust in him and lean not to our own understanding, but lean to his understanding and acknowledge him in every area in our life, he said he shall direct your paths. So that's what we have to do. So no matter what your situation, no matter what your circumstance is, okay, ask God for a peace that surpasses all understanding, because peace is everything. Peace. I'm 33. That ain't old or that ain't young. I'm somewhere in the middle. But the older I get, the more peace that I want. And I'm okay with peace. That's all I want is peace. I don't want to argue with nobody. I don't want to fight with nobody. None of that. Because life is too short. The way these folks leaving here, I ain't got time for that. I ain't got time for nothing but Jesus and what he want me to do, what he want me to say in my life and get my life together, doing what God tell me to do. That's all I got time for. I don't have time for the extra or the drama. I got time for peace. Peace. Now, if you like drama or mess or being unhappy or miserable, then hey, more power to you, because they say misery loves company. But Sasha don't want no parts of that. So we have to ask God for a peace that surpasses all understanding. All understanding and everything, even if it don't make sense to you. Okay, say, "Lord, give me a peace that surpasses all understanding." That means everything that don't make sense to you. Ask for a peace. Because peace is everything. Peace is valuable. They say the best things in life are free, and that's true. So Luke chapter 10 verse 19 says, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over the power of the enemy. Nothing shall harm you by any means." So basically, we got the power to trample on snakes and scorpions. The devil is a snake. He is a serpent. So basically, God is saying, I have given you, okay, if you a child of God, God is saying, I have given you the power to trample over the enemy. That mean people. That mean anything that the devil throw at you, no matter what it is. God said, I have given you the power to trample on snakes and scorpions. In other words, to defeat the enemy or defeat whatever is coming at you that you know is not of God. So Isaiah 54:17, this is one of my favorite verses. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. So that means that if you a child of God and you believe in God, you believe in Jesus and that he died for you, for the sins of the whole world, that means that though the weapons may form, they shall not prosper. No matter what it is, they gonna form. Jesus never said that you wouldn't have trials and tribulations, or you wouldn't have hardships, or that life was gonna be easy. But what he did say is no weapon formed against you shall prosper. And that comes from Isaiah 54:17. So you may not have control over your circumstances, but God has given you the authority over your day and over your life. So you have to know how to use that authority. When I was in my bed recently, about 3 weeks, and I felt so defeated and so down and just didn't have no energy, and I felt fatigued and confused and just felt like giving up and felt like throwing in the towel and felt like giving up on this ministry and all these different things. I felt like giving up. That's how I felt. But God has already given me the power and the authority to do whatever I set my mind to do. Okay, his word tells us that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So what I'm trying to tell y'all is the Bible is a living word, okay? It's a living word. That means that everything that you face in your life, it's an answer for it in the Bible. No matter what it is. No matter what it is. That's why it's so big. That's why it's so thick. Because it's an instruction manual. God love you enough and love me enough to leave us an instruction manual, which is the Bible, which is a holy book, which is the living word of God. It's a living word. No matter what you go through in your life, no matter what you face, it's a scripture in that book for every area and every trial and every tribulation in your life. It may not be the words that we use today, or the sicknesses of today, or whatever, because these things were not around back then. But the scripture, the words, is something in there for everything that you face. Everything. That's why it's so thick. That's why it's called a living word, because it is an actual living word that God spoke through his prophets and his apostles and his disciples, and they had dreams and visions and all of these things, and he spoke to them. And so it's an actual living word. Okay, so it's too many people, this has been in my spirit for so long, it's too many people not walking in their authority. And I know, because I suffered from depression and anxiety for years, my whole entire adult life. I was only on medication once last year. So two times in my whole life was I on medication for anxiety and depression. And I had major depression and I had major anxiety. And I didn't know before I got saved the power that I have. Most people don't know the power that they have. They don't know. They don't know that they have more power than the devil. They don't know that. But the only way you're going to know that is if you read the word. If you read it and ask God to give you understanding to understand it. Because if you just read in the Bible like it's a chore, you ain't going to have no understanding. You have to read it for an understanding. You know, it's a living word. It's a holy book. So some things in the Bible are straightforward and plain, but other things are not. You need wisdom and discernment to understand some things in the Bible. So it's too many people who are not walking in their authority. But I came to tell you on this here morning, even though I was hyped up in the shower, I was like, yes, Holy Spirit, I got a word for the people. I'm finna talk to the people. And guess what? When I got in this car, it went away. I ain't even feel like getting on here. But see, that ain't nothing but the enemy. That's how he worked. He knew that I was all, okay, I got a word for the people. And then as soon as I got in this car, I was like, Lord, I don't even feel like getting on here no more. But I have to be obedient because it's people who need to hear this. Just like it's people on YouTube. Sometimes I don't be feeling like doing nothing. It be plenty of times I be lazy. I don't feel like getting out of bed or whatever. Whatever. Just being honest. Y'all know I'm transparent. But I might hop on YouTube. And some people who I watch, they'll get me hyped up or they'll get me out my funk or whatever it is. And I'll be like, oh, okay. You see how that work? Them spirits, that's why I say spirits are real. And they travel. People can kill your vibes. Situation can kill your vibes. But if I'm feeling some type of way and then I watch somebody on YouTube and they got me feeling better and feeling happy and motivated, then it spreads. Happiness is contagious. Misery is contagious. That's why you have to be careful about who you be around, because them spirits and demons is real. So if they get me happy and motivated on YouTube after I watch them, then guess what? That's going to get me up out of my bed. I'm going to jump up and I'm going to be like, oh, okay. They done gave me and said to me what I need to go speak to the people on Facebook. You see how that work? That's how that work. So it's too many people not walking in their authority. But I came to tell you on today, you have the authority. God has already given you the authority, okay? You have the authority. The devil is not more powerful than you, okay? And I'm about to get into that. And woo, child, I done got hot in this car with you. Whew, wait a minute. Hold on, y'all. Okay, I was cold, but ooh, it's hot now. I can't see for the sun. Can y'all see me? Because I can't see. Okay. So, yeah, I was saying it's too many people that's not walking in their authority. So, I want to say this. The Holy Spirit was speaking to me while I was in the car before I got on here. And I was writing. And so the Lord said, we give the devil too much power. The devil is powerful, but he's not more powerful than God, okay? And if we were made in God's image, then that means that we're more powerful than the devil. Okay? If we were made in God's image, then that means we're more powerful than the devil. Bothering me because I cannot see. Okay, so the devil, he just wants us to think that he's more powerful than us, but he is not. Okay, he is not more powerful than us, and I'm gonna explain it to you. Satan is a liar, okay, and a thief, and what he comes to do is steal, kill, and destroy. He is a manipulator. He's a liar. Okay, he's a thief. Okay, he deceived Adam and Eve. Well, he deceived Eve. So his job is to deceive you. That's why he's called an adversary. So he be on his job. Okay, people, that's why it's called devil's advocate. Okay, he is on his job. So that's why you have to be on your job. Okay, the enemy don't play fair. So he don't play fair with you, so you can't play fair with him, or you shouldn't play fair with him. See, I messed up when I let the devil play with me for 3 weeks, and I know the word, okay? I studied it, and I was in my room for about 3 weeks, in my feelings, down, and didn't have no energy, tired, didn't feel like doing nothing, okay? I ain't gonna say I was depressed, I just felt defeated, and that's how I felt. For 3 weeks straight, y'all, strong. I'm talking about the only reason why I got up out of bed is because it was a few people who had said some encouraging stuff to me. And one of the girls was like, Sasha, no. So, after that conversation, and I still didn't get up that day. I didn't get up out of that bed till like 2 or 3 days later after that. And I finally got up and I said, okay, Lord, today is the day. I done been in this room, in this bed long enough. I got to get up out of here and I got to do what you told me to do. So that's what I did. And I've been back on here ever since. Because it's some people who need motivating. It's some people who need encouraging. It's some people who need to hear the word. You know, a lot of people may not like me. That's okay. I've never really been one to care who like me or who don't. But I'm going to give you the word. And it's up to, you know, whoever to receive it or not. You may not have to receive it from me. That's okay. That's perfectly fine, you know. But I'm going to do what God have called me to do at the end of the day. So that's just what it is. So 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 11 says, do not be deceived of Satan's devices, Do not be deceived of Satan's devices. Okay, so if you are a child of God, y'all, and your heavenly Father is the creator of you, and you were made in his image, okay, then why would God give the devil more power than you? You know, the Holy Spirit gave that to me when I was just in the car. If I'm a child of God and I'm made in my Father's image, because we are made in the image of God, then why would my Father give the devil more power than me? That don't even make sense. And that came to me in the car before I got on here. I'm like, you know, I never really thought about it that way. Why would God give the devil more power than us if we his children and we made in his image? That don't even make sense. You see what I'm saying? That's the mass manipulation. That's what I'm talking about, the enemy, them demons and them spirits and them strongholds and generational curses. That's what I'm saying. He a liar. He the father of lies. Why would our Father give him more power than us? That don't even make sense. That's just like if your dad a business owner or a drug lord or a thug or whatever, or somebody with power or a high position with money and power and fame and fortune, and he got an enemy, okay? No matter who he is, and he got an enemy. Why would your earthly father, okay, whoever he is, whether he be a doctor or a lawyer or actor or preacher, somebody in position with power and fame and all of this stuff, and your father got an enemy, why would your father get his enemy more power than his child? That don't even make sense. Do that make sense? The Lord gave me that before I got on here, and I was like, you know, I ain't never thought about it like that. Like, that don't even make sense. Your Father, I would hope he gonna equip you with everything that you need to protect yourself, right? Whether it be a gun, or teach you how to fight, or how to whatever. He gonna give you everything you need. He gonna equip you with what you need to protect yourself. Okay, no matter what it is. So, why would God give the enemy more power than his children? That don't make sense. So, Satan is a liar and a thief and a master manipulator. So, we have to put him in his place. When the devil tempted Jesus in the desert, okay, and he tried to get Jesus to, he tempted him two times. What he tried to tempt him to do? Oh, yeah. When Jesus was fasting for 40 days and 40 nights when he was in the desert, and the devil tried to tempt Jesus and said, you know, I'm paraphrasing, but basically the devil tried to get Jesus to eat some bread and he was fasting. And the Lord told him no. He told him no. And he tried to bribe him with something else. You know, I think Jesus went up on the mountaintop or something in the desert, and Satan told him, look over, if you just bow down to me, you can have all of this. Okay, this is what the enemy told Jesus when he was trying to tempt him in the desert. He said, if you bow down and worship me, you can have all of this. And you know what Jesus told him? He said, get thee behind me, Satan. He said, why do I gotta bow down to you when this is already mine? All of this is mine. He said, my father gave this to me. I don't got to bow down to you. So, you know, that said me, thank you, Holy Spirit. That tell me we ain't got to bow down to the devil for nothing that's already ours. It has already been given to us. We give the devil too much power over us and over our life and over our situation. Okay? And let him take control over us and beat us up and have us around here broken, stressed, and busted and disgusted and looking ugly and worried about this person and that person, what they got to think and what they got to say and all this and that. We give the enemy too much power and too much credit. He powerful, but he ain't more powerful than God. He is not all powerful. He is not all knowing. Only God is all powerful. Only God is all knowing, not Satan. So what I want to say is, if you don't know that you're in a spiritual battle daily, okay, then the enemy is he out to get your soul. And if you don't know that you're in a war, you're in a daily war. That's what you in. You in a daily war. He out for your soul. Because the devil don't like us, y'all. He don't like us. He hate us. Because he know ultimately he's going to the lake of fire. So that's why he out here deceiving people. And using people. And people being used by the enemy. And they don't even know it. That's why I try not to even get offended by stuff that people do or say or whatever, because some people are being used by the enemy and they don't even know it. It's a lot of people that's battling demons, that's battling strongholds and generational curses and all this type of stuff, and they don't even know it. So me being in ministry, me being in knowing warfare and knowing about generational curses and strongholds and spirits and demons and all this stuff, because I have already conquered this stuff. That's why I can get on here and I can preach about it, because I've already conquered it. Not to say that I don't still go through stuff and still battle stuff, but I know how to fight. The word of God says that our weapons are not carnal. What does that mean? That means you cannot fight the enemy with a gun and a knife. How do you fight the enemy? You fight him with the word of God. The word of God is the Bible. The Bible is your sword. That's how you defeat the enemy. That's how you defeat him and put him in his place. By putting your full armor of God on. That's how you defeat him. You're going to look crazy trying to shoot at the devil with a gun. Or trying to cut him or stab him with a knife. You can't do it. You cannot do it. You cannot do it. Weapons of warfare are not carnal, y'all. They're not carnal. What is carnal? That's worldly stuff. That's worldly stuff. That's not how that go. So we give the devil too much power. Okay, Jesus. Let me tell you what Jesus did for us. Okay, Jesus defeated the devil at the cross. Okay, he has been defeated, but he a liar and a thief and a manipulator, and he wants you to think that he ain't been defeated, but he has already been defeated. When Jesus died on the cross at Calvary, he already defeated the devil. That's why before he died on that cross, he said, it is finished. It's so much power in them three words. It is finished. It is finished. It is done. It is written. It's a wrap. Because he had came to do what God sent him to do in the first place. And that was to die for the sins of the whole world. Okay, that's why he said it is finished. So when he said it is finished, that means that the devil was defeated. I came here. I fought, I preached, I talked, I died, I got beaten, I got mocked, I got spit on, I got criticized, I got judged, I got all of that. It is finished. It is finished. So when he said, when he hung his head on that cross and he said, it is finished, the devil was defeated. But the devil don't want you to know that, but I know it, so he can't fool me, he can't get over on me. Because I already know what's up. That's why I pray for people. I intercessed for people this morning before I got on here. I prayed for 6 people that I'm not going to say who they is. But that's what an intercessor is. If you don't know what an intercessor is or an intercession is, that's somebody who prays on behalf of other people. And I ain't talking about praying on their downfall or praying bad or wishing bad on them. No, I'm talking about praying for them. For their welfare, for the enemy to praying for them to prosper, for healing, for their good, basically. To pray for their good, to break generational curses, to bind up curses, to bind up strongholds, all that stuff. That's what an intercessor is. And that's what I do. I intercess. I intercede on other people's behalf. People who may not know God or people whose relationship with God may not be as strong as mine. People in my family, my friends, my enemies. That's what the Bible tells us. He said, pray for your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. Pray for those who despitefully use you. That's in the Word. That's in the Word. Ooh, this sun ain't playing fair. It wasn't this hot when I came out here. I can't even see for the sun. Whew. But anyway, I'm almost done. I'm almost done. So, John 16 and 33 says, in the world, you'll have trouble, okay? But be courageous. I've already overcome the world. This is what Jesus said, y'all. He said, you will have trouble, but be courageous. I have already overcome the world. And how did he already overcome the world, y'all? By dying on the cross for the sins of the whole world. That's how he has already conquered the world or overcome the world. So Romans 8 and 31 says, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? That's why I walk around. Even when I had lost my mind, I was walking around. I was so invincible, but that was like I was so invincible, but that was nothing but spiritual warfare. But now that I'm back in my, I still walk around like I'm invincible. Like can't nobody touch me. Like can't nobody do nothing to me. And I'm about to explain to you why. I'm about to explain to you why I feel like that. Can't nobody do nothing to me. Yeah, I can get shot, but can't nobody do nothing to me that God ain't allowed them to do to me. Nothing. So I walk around like I am invincible because I know who I am and I know who my Father is. And I know I'm a soldier in the battle of the army of the Lord. And I feel like can't nobody touch me. Can't nobody do nothing to me because I know who I am in Christ. And see, when you know who you is in Christ, and you know what your purpose is, and you know who your Heavenly Father is, and you know what God called you to do, then you can walk around like you invincible too. That's why it's so important to know what your purpose is, to know what your calling is, to stay prayed up and to have a relationship with God. Because see, when you got a relationship with God and you know God for real, then you can walk around like you invincible and bold and courageous too. Because see, I ask God, give me a boldness, give me courage, give me wisdom, give me discernment, give me all of that. Yeah, that's what I do. So I think I'm invincible, like for real, for real. This ain't play for play. So even though sometimes I be fearful or I be nervous or feeling discouraged or whatever, I have to shake that off. I have to shake that off because see, that ain't nothing but the enemy. Okay, God is not the God of confusion. Satan is the author of confusion, not God. So if I'm feeling all them type of ways, that ain't nothing but the enemy. And what he's trying to do, he's trying to make stumbling blocks for me to prevent me from what God called to do. Because see, somebody need to hear this right now because I need to hear it. So that's what he do. He come to steal, kill, and destroy. But we should not be deceived of the devices of Satan. Okay, y'all, you have to keep your full armor on at all times. If you don't know what the full armor of God is, go to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, and it'll tell you what your full armor is. But you put on your helmet of salvation. Okay, Jesus died at the cross for your sins. Your helmet of salvation. The sword. You fight with your sword. That's the word of God. The gospel of peace. Okay. Your belt of truth. And it's another one. One or two that I'm leaving out. But it's okay. Go to Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12. And it'll tell you or look up the full armor of God. The whole armor of God. That's what you do. That's how you take a stance against the enemy. God ain't put that in the word because he thought it was cute. Oh, let me tell my children to put on the whole armor of God. No. He put it in there because he wanted you to know how to defend yourself against the enemy. That's why he put it in the word. Because he wanted to equip you to know how to fight the enemy, to not be defeated, to not be around here getting beat up by depression, to be getting beat up by anxiety, to be getting beat up by people and what they got to say about you and what they got to think about you and get beat up by bills and stuff. He said, put your forearm on, sleep in it, go to sleep in it. That's what you do. I sleep in my, because you got to be ready for the enemy. He can't come sneak me. He might get me down and out, but he got to get back because I know what's up. I'm a soldier in the battle of the army of the Lord. Oh, the Lord, he can't run up on me because I know how to fight. The word say our weapons are not carnal. They ain't carnal, y'all. They not carnal. So, I'm going to read that again. Romans 8:31 say, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? And that's just so powerful. It'll have you feeling invincible. Like, God is for me. Who can be against me? Can't nobody do nothing to me. They can't do nothing to me. So, that's what you have to do. So, 1 John chapter 4, verse 4 says, the one who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. So that just means that the spirit of God that is in you is greater than he who is in the world. And who is he who is in the world? The devil. Like I said, we have more power than the devil. Do not be deceived, okay? Jesus already defeated the devil at the cross. And the devil wants you to think that he have not been defeated. But he is defeated. Because Jesus defeated him when he said, it is finished. So I pray that this message has blessed somebody today. I know it has because it's blessed me. And I needed to hear this. Okay. So if you didn't catch it from the beginning, go back and watch the replay. And if you want to add my group, Sisters in Christ in House of Prayer, send me a request and I will add you. And I pray that you guys have a blessed and prosperous and wonderful day. In the name of Jesus. Amen.